Okay.
Oh, yes.
What?
You made it. You pulled it off.
And saying we're glad you're here. Hope you made it to the refreshment table. And feel free to make your way over there throughout the morning and to coffee and whatnot. We'll say thanks this morning to Gail Stapleton and Beth Meyer for providing our refreshments, and to Deb Schneider for coordinating our refreshments throughout the series. There are handouts that hopefully you've gotten onto your table so that you can see as we see some of the scriptures and some of the things that they will be referring to during the lecture today. Really don't have any other announcements other than to say that we will come back next week, not for the telephone lecture series, but for a Palm Sunday class where we'll be doing Visio Divina, that is, reflecting on some of the images that have been provided to us by Sanctified Art as we reflect on Holy Week that's coming up. So some of the art for Holy Week as a way of preparing ourselves for that week to come. So as we begin, if I could offer a word of prayer. God, whose life is eternal, as we gather for this last lecture on the Bible and the last things, we contemplate these biblical images and metaphors, wondering what they reveal to us about the nature of our hope. We thank you for Dale Allison, for his curious faith, his vigorous mind, and his honest reflections with us about our Christian faith. As he speaks to us, help us to be open to what you would show us about yourself, about ourselves, and about our future with you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. It's my pleasure to welcome once again to the podium, Professor Dale Allison.
Thanks, Mike. Good morning, everybody. I did not enjoy last week. Part of me feels a need to apologize, but when I reflect, I realize that I do not control the weather. We had 60 mile an hour winds where I was last week, and I don't control the central main power grid, so you don't get an apology. The subject of resurrection, which we looked at 2 or 3 weeks ago, today's topic, the second coming, appears in the creeds. And you all are probably used to reciting, he sitteth at the right hand of God, from whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. That's the second coming. The first was back there in the first century. Now, traditionally, this is for Christians the central event marking the end of the world, or at least the world as we know it, ordinary history. Do you ever think about this? You ever wonder what will happen at the end? And you ever ask, who taught you this? Mike, let's start with these pictures, okay? So picture number one should be from about 4 centuries ago.
Yep, it's coming.
That's not it. Okay, there we go. All right. So this is a good news, bad news, second coming picture. This is Jesus who will rule the world. So there's a globe under his feet. And what you can see is there's a sword on the upper right and it's red. And then there are flowers on the left. So the sword is for judgment and it's bloody. And the wicked will suffer judgment. But the righteous, well, they will experience the merciful deity, and the flower represents that. So this is a good picture and a bad picture, depending on whether you're righteous or wicked. All right. Since this is a modern American Protestant group, let's get 3 modern American Protestant pictures. Okay, so here's Jesus kind of floating on the air. That looks like fun. I'd like to do that if I could. And he's accompanied by... Well, I have to interview the artist and ask, are these angels or are these saints who have become angels? I'm not sure, but they've all got trumpets, so it's very, very loud. And then people are rising from the dead. Here they look to me like they're greeting Jesus. So this is more or less happy. How about the next one? Okay, this is similar. Jesus is up there, and it's always bright, right? Why is it always bright? And people are like this. I guess this is what? Welcoming, wondering. There he is. By the way, this is very, very literal. And you can ask yourself, well, if this is what happens in Durham, North Carolina, what is happening in Thailand? Do they all have the same picture? How can this happen everywhere the same way? Right? But the artists aren't thinking about that. This is a very literal way of doing this. And part of the problem is given by scripture, which says, every eye will see him. And so some people who worry about this say, well, maybe it's television and everybody will see Jesus on a big screen, right? Well, anyway, here these people are luckily located and they get to see him. All right, the next. Ooh, I don't like this one. I don't like this one. So this is Jesus as warrior. And the horses are white, but they're obviously war horses. And he has a sword and there's no flower this time, right? And... look at the only thing at the bottom is liquid fire. So this is Jesus come for judgment. And I don't know what's going on in the upper left. So this is imagination. But it has held, this idea of the second coming, held an important role in Christian imagination down through the centuries. I remember my first engagement with this issue. My father, in 1970, bought a book called The Late Great Planet Earth by a man named Hal Lindsey. Mike, I think you've got a picture of this. Now, this says, this is a copy from the 70s. This says over 1 million copies in print. That number became 35 million. This was the best-selling nonfiction book of the 1970s by a mile. By many, many miles. It was also translated into more than 50 languages. This was a major book. Actually, this was turned into a documentary in 1978, and they got Orson Welles, the great Orson Welles, to be the voice of that so-called alleged documentary. Also remember at this time reading a book by a man named Salem Kirwan called 666. There were lots of these in the 70s, but the biggest thing of all happened in the 1990s in this country. So Mike, how about the next one? So a guy named Tim LaHaye, who had written a book on the Second Coming way back in the early 70s, but then spent the next 20 years talking about evangelical sex lives and best-selling books on Christians and sex, went back to eschatology and got rich. I don't know how many sequels there were to this. I don't know how many movies were made on the basis of this, but this was a sensation. I remember at one point walking into Barnes & Noble, and there was a children's display for the children's versions of these books. This was a big deal. There was a huge appetite for this, at least in North America. Now, if you put these three books that I've mentioned together, Late Great Planet or 666 and Left Behind, they have a similar scheme. A similar scheme about the last days. And here's how it goes. Christians, the good Christians, hopefully many in this church, will be raptured. That is, they will just disappear or ascend to heaven at some point. Then this will be followed by 7 years of horror when the Antichrist will rule the world, in some schemes, rule it for 3.5 years. But this is the so-called Great Tribulation. And after this 7 years, Jesus will come again, which is actually for the third time now, because he came in the first century. He came back for the rapture, right? And now he's coming back again to Jerusalem, where he will reign for 1,000 years. This third coming, if you will be preceded by the repentance of Israel. Jews will become Christians, in effect, and then there will be a kingdom of Israel set up in Jerusalem. By the way, this is a Presbyterian church, and you should note that Presbyterian theologians have officially rejected this idea. In a statement issued in 1978 by one of our official groups, I've never known anyone on these committees, but anyway, that's kidding. Into this statement that said, among other things, we believe in one return of Christ. If you read this in context, it's a polemic against this idea that Christ is coming for a rapture the second time, and then there'll be a third coming. Now, I don't recommend to my students that they read Late Great Planet Earth or the Left Behind series or 666 or any books in this genre. And I'm going to share with you now three reasons why I do not do this. First of all, think about this scheme. There's the rapture, when Christians all zoom up to heaven, the good Christians, the real ones, and then 7 years of horror and terror and misery and antichrist. Then the repentance of Israel, followed by 1,000 years of a kingdom set up in, geographically, Israel. We can date the invention of this idea, and we can name its inventor. It was invented in 1825 by a man named John Nelson Darby, who was the founder of the Plymouth Brethren. Now, I actually had a very dear friend who was a Plymouth Brethren pastor. I learned a lot from him. He was a wonderful person. And so, and I have some affection for some Plymouth Brethren, but they tend to be very historically, very, very conservative. And this scheme was invented by their founder. And what happened is he came and lectured in America in the middle of the 19th century. And he persuaded a man named Dwight L. Moody that he was right. Dwight L. Moody was one of the biggest evangelists of the 19th century. And he ended up with Moody Bible College, Moody Bible Institute, Moody Press. And it was not long after Moody became converted that somebody else produced a version of the King James Bible called the Scofield Reference Bible. By a man named, you guessed it, Scofield, who was to this. And if you read the Bible, you will see that this scheme is in the Bible. So as you are reading biblical text, reading Matthew 24 or 1 Thessalonians or the book of Daniel or Revelation, this scheme is there that I just shared with you as though it's just an obvious part of scripture, right? So these are the innocent markings at the bottom and the side of the page, and the scheme is there for you right in the Bible. My wife grew up in a church that had Scofield Bibles. My mother grew up in a household that had Scofield Bibles. But this was invented in 1825, this scheme. As a church historian, I can tell you, nobody ever fought this before then. Now, I have a rule with my students. It goes like this. People have been reading the Bible for a long, long time. And if you have a truly original, novel idea about this text, that so many people have been reading, many of them very, very intelligent and very learned, and you see something totally new, the odds are that you are wrong. So, that's point number one, but I have to read this. I just have to read this. This has to do with the rapture. This refers, now by the way, this is a story that is horrific and hilarious. Horrific and hilarious. Okay. This is about an Ozarks woman who attempted to join what she believed to be the rapture of the second coming while riding with her husband along an Arkansas road. Sorry, I grew up in Kansas. Arkansas. In the gathering dusk along the highway, the woman glimpsed what she believed to be Christ, his arms uplifted, saluting the saintly earthbound as they rose heavenward. In truth, it was a man who had set out in his pickup truck for a masquerade party dressed as Jesus Christ. His costume entourage included 12 disciples he had gathered beneath the tarp in the bed of his pickup. The disciples were actually inflatable dates sold at a nearby adult bookstore. He had filled the biomannequins with helium and was attempting to secure a loose tether of the truck tarp on the berm when several of his inflated truck mates escaped and began ascending heavenward. The rapture smitten woman glimpsing a windshield view of this chaos as her husband began to slow their car, opened the sunroof, climbed out crying, "Take me, Lord," lost her balance and fell in front of the vehicle behind her alone. The Lord granted her wish. Horrible and hilarious, yeah. Right? Okay, now here's the second reason I don't recommend these books to my students. Christians have always thought that the end is near. They have always thought that the end is near, and your handout is proof. Your handout is proof. Starting with Ignatius, writing 110, these are the last times, so let us be reverent. Let us fear the patience of God, lest it become a judgment against us. And then we have quotation after quotation after quotation. I don't know if I achieved it for this handout, but I think I might have one for every single century, at least one for every single century. And this includes Roman Catholics, it includes Protestants, it includes Eastern Orthodox, and it includes Protestants of various kinds. At one point on here, you have a quotation from Christopher Columbus. The greatest part of the prophecies and the Holy Scriptures is already finished. I said above that much remain for the completion of the prophecies, and I say that there are great things in the world, and I say that the sign is that our Lord is hastening them. The preaching of this gospel in so many lands in recent times tells it to me. There is a verse in Matthew and Mark about the gospel being preached before all these things come to pass. And Columbus was reading this, like many missionaries, Protestant missionaries in the 19th century, and thinking, if we evangelize, or once the whole world is evangelized, then Jesus will come again. Botticelli, you know Botticelli from art class way back in junior high school or high school, right? Birth of Venus and all these angels and cherubs and philosophers and so on. He thought that the world would end within 3 years. And he died in something like 1511, something like that. Martin Luther thought the end was near. Printing is the latest and greatest gift by which God enables us to advance the things of the gospel. It is the last bright flame manifesting itself just previous to the extinction of the world. Thanks be to God, it came before the last day came. Now, one of these quotations, he's getting a little more conservative, and he say, well, it might just be within the next 100 years. But the last one, it often occurs to me forcibly that the last day will break before we can completely turn the Holy Scriptures into German. He's translating, trying to get it done before Jesus comes back. There's a quotation here from Samuel Rutherford, who was a very famous Protestant divine back in the day, and the Presbyterian. So the Presbyterians are on this list too, as are the Methodists. There's a lovely quotation here from John Wesley. John Wesley is one of my favorites, but he got this wrong. He thought that the end was at hand. The Seventh-day Adventists got started when somebody predicted that Jesus would return on October 2nd, 1844. That was a bold prediction. I read a book about this date once, and it really made me feel sad because there were lots of people who really, really thought that some of the people sold everything they had because they didn't need it anymore. I remember reading about people who dressed in their choir robes, their white ascension robes, getting ready to zoom up to heaven. Some people who climbed trees waiting for Jesus to come before midnight. Very, very sad. Also, and anyway, though, the people who weren't completely disillusioned end up founding the Seventh-day Adventists. There was a book published in 1988 entitled 88 Reasons Why the Rapture Will Be in 1988. Then there is also represented here a man named Harold Camping, who predicted that Jesus would come in originally September 6, 1994. And then Jesus didn't come back, so he said, I was wrong. It's going to be October 2nd, 1994. And then again, he put it off a little, May 21st, 2011. It was actually a fascinating documentary, which used to be at least available on Amazon, called Apocalypse Later. And Camping, for the third date, allowed someone to follow him around and interview his parishioners and to see what happened as the date approached and nothing. Okay, now this still goes on today. I have a clipping here. This was in USA Today, published September 2021. Some say COVID-19 vaccine is the mark of the beast. I know people. I've never thought that Jesus was coming soon or next week. I know people who do. I have known such people my whole life. I have liked and loved many of them. But I had a moment of revelation many years ago when I was cleaning out my grandmother's attic. She was moving, and there were some old dusty books up in the attic that nobody had looked at for decades. And I pulled one off the shelf. And it was about the second coming, and it was written during World War I. And I looked at it, I read some of it, I thought, yeah, I could see how somebody living in 1916 could think this is the end. This is hell. If you know anything about World War I, this is hell. And a whole generation of young people is dying out. And then such books were written during World War II and the Civil War. And I discovered at some point as an historian that every time things look really horrible, people think maybe this is the end. And it's always possible to look around. There are always earthquakes somewhere, and there is always war somewhere, and there is always death and destruction somewhere, which are the signs of the end, right? So the moral of the story is that nobody has been able to predict the end by using the Bible, and I don't see any reason to think things are going to change. By the way, if you were to look at my list, which we're not going to, you get to take it home if you want to look at it, that's fine. But a lot of those names are really important people, people we study in seminary, not just marginal people that you can dismiss as crackpots. A lot of these people we pay attention to. They're the varsity squad. They're the people in the theological pro bowl. A lot of these names are important people. All right. Now, here's the third reason I don't give my students these books. Jesus says in Mark 13, and it's repeated in Matthew 24, that concerning that day or hour, he does not know. Okay, that's pretty straightforward, it seems to me. And by the way, Harold Camping, who gave 3 days after the third failure, finally said, well, didn't Jesus say nobody knows the day or the hour, so I was wrong. But he knew that verse before. What was wrong with him? Okay. Why do we have this tendency to think that the end is near? Because it's all over our tradition. And by the way, if you look into Buddhism, you can find that there are Buddhists who have thought the end was coming soon at some point. You actually can look all over the world and find that there have been groups in almost every place and time and of almost every religion who have thought this must be it. There's several reasons. One is that people often think that the present is decadent and maybe worse than any time before it. Now, things are always terrible, right? Things are always terrible, as I said before. But it often seems, I don't know the psychology of this, but it often seems that things are getting worse, maybe because we idealize the past or our youth or something. I remember my father going through the 1960s. He was a small town Kansas boy who went through the Depression and was a soldier in the Second World War. He did not understand flag burning. He did not understand bra burning. He did not understand long hair. He did not understand rock and roll. And he thought the world was going to hell. Well, I learned to love rock and roll, and I grew my hair very, very long when I could do so. And I usually teach in tennis shoes and jeans. So I like the 1960s. But now when I get together with my old friends, we sit around and we say it and we mean it. The students are not as good as they used to be. And the theologians aren't as good as they used to be. All my favorite theologians are dead. And the historians certainly aren't as good as they used to be. Sitting around saying, gosh, things are falling apart. Well, it's just some part of us that doesn't. By the way, you can find this already in Plato. The youth are going crazy, right? Back there in 4th century Athens. I think the second thing is that, for whatever reason, fear does sell. And these books about the last things are full of fear. They are full of death, and they are sometimes very gory. The best-selling author during my lifetime has been Stephen King. People like to be scared. They like to be terrified. They like to read about death and murder. I don't know why. I don't know why fear works. But it does. It does. And Earth and Late Great Planet Earth 666. These other books, they are full of mayhem and death and scary stuff. I think the third reason that this hope for an era makes sense is because people are always alienated. I'm alienated from the world. I don't know about you, but I think if you're honest, there are many, many things about this world that you hate. I love Genesis 1, and I believe the world is good, but I believe the world has gone off the rails. And you all know people who have had leukemia. You know people who had leukemia when they were young. You know people who have died from cancer, and not just when they're 98, right? People who have been taken too soon. You know about war. You know that there are people in our world, a great number, who are so depressed that they commit suicide. It's a large number of people. What a miserable place this is that happens. And you could just talk about all the economic, educational, racial disparity and go on forever and ever. I have a very long list of all the things I hate about this world, some of which are caused by people, but some of which are just part of the natural world. And it makes sense for people to say, surely God must fix things and will fix things soon. Surely. Why not? Why is God tardy? I think the fourth thing, at least with these rapture books, is that everybody is a little afraid of death, especially people on the younger side of 70. And the rapture is a way to get out of this world without dying. That's pretty neat. I'm going to die. Oh, Jesus, take me one day. Okay, that's wonderful, huh? Okay, here's a problem, though. Everything I've said now is sort of, I don't know, skeptical, cynical. But you know what? This idea that the end is near crops up originally in the Bible, in the New Testament. This is Paul. You know what time it is? How it is now the moment for you to wake up from sleep? For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. I know what that means. 1 Corinthians 10. Now, these things happened to them as a warning, but they were written down for our instruction, upon whom the end of the ages has come. You find the same notion in Hebrews, in James, in 1 Peter. This goes back to Jesus' disciples. In Luke 19, it says that Jesus told them a parable because they thought the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. And in Acts 1, after Jesus rises from the dead, they say, hey, is this the time you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel and fix everything? Set it right? This goes back to day one, folks. This has always been with us. So how do we respond? Well, I'm going to make several suggestions here. Here's the first suggestion. The first suggestion is I think we need to be honest and we need to look at our tradition and the scriptures and say, we have Christians, many Christians, have always hoped that the end was at hand. Just be honest, we have. And it goes back to the beginning. The second thing is that for a reason I just introduced, I understand this. And I actually, some days, wish it were true. That is, sometimes I've decided in my own mind to do a little role playing. What would it be like to be God? What would it be like to be the all-merciful, the all-loving, the all-compassionate, who knows everything, and who is looking at our world right now, every day, and seeing people who are murdered, seeing people who are enslaved, seeing people who are raped, seeing people whose parents beat them, and it goes on and on and on and on. Little children born with medical problems, physical problems, mental disabilities. I have gotten myself in the mood sometimes where I have thought, if I were the all-compassionate, And if I knew everything that was going on, and if I had the power, I would just scream and stop it. I would just scream and stop it now. Why doesn't God do that? I don't know. I guess that's the problem of evil, and our theologians and philosophers have never solved this, so I'm not going to solve it. All I can tell you is, in some moods, it makes sense to think, if God is really madly in love with you and me and everyone, and madly in God with this world gone wrong, why doesn't God fix it right now, today? Why is God tardy? Here's the third thing, I think, and by the way, I'm not being dogmatic about anything here. My own view is that given what I believe, given my faith, what I think about God, that God must win in the end. I believe that as part of my fundamental theological faith. But I don't know when this will happen. I don't know how it will happen. I have no idea how it will look. None at all. Actually, none. When I look at the pictures of the second coming that we started with, I say, well, those are artistic imagination. And I'm inclined to say, you know what? Maybe Jesus had something when he decided to speak mostly in parables about the kingdom of God. Maybe that's all we have. We have some stories. We have some comparisons. It's going to be kind of like this and so on. It's like when we were talking about heaven. I said we have little models of heaven. We have things we can imagine, but they're not the reality, right? So I think God will win, but I don't know how. I don't know what this looks like. I have trouble with literal interpretations of, let's say, the book of Revelation or the second coming, because just as I pointed up out here, how is everybody going to see the same thing from different vantage points around a globe, which is pretty big? So I don't have any prosaic descriptions. Now then the question becomes, this is an interesting question, what do I do with the fact that my scriptures and my tradition, including people I otherwise admire, respect, and learn from, thought the end was near? Well, here's my approach, for better or for worse. I tend to think in terms of function. And I ask myself, how did this belief or has this belief functioned? Now, sometimes it's been a horrible way of terrifying people, and I don't like that. But I think the second coming has been functionally a way to comfort people. Yes, God is coming back for us, and God is coming soon. God loves us. God will fix it. This has been a way to comfort people. It has been a way also to motivate and warn people, to motivate us because we don't know when the end will come, to make us serious, and to help us feel responsibility because we will not always be here and be able to fix the things that we need to fix. And as I have thought about this, I've come to the conclusion that my own death and your own death should function the same way. It can function the same way. And your death is the end of your world. All our deaths are the end of the world in miniature. So first of all, if I ask, when am I going to die? What's the answer to that? Well, here's how I think about it. I am going to be dead in 40 years. Probably dead in 30 years. Maybe dead in 20 years. And possibly tomorrow. I do not know when the end, my end is coming. So my end is always near. Also, when I think about my end and death, I believe that God will come for me. And so I get comfort from this thought, but I'm also motivated because I realize I'm not always going to be here. I have opportunities that I will not always have and things that need to be fixed now before I depart. I think thinking about death makes me sober and serious and reinforces my sense of responsibility. The rabbis, the old Jewish rabbis, had a saying that I like very much. Repent the day before your death. We don't know when we are going. And if you take that seriously, it means repent today. And by the way, psychologists know that when people are given a medical death sentence, you have 4 weeks to live, or 6 weeks to live, or 2 months to live, they live a little differently than they otherwise did. And sometimes for the better, because they think, oh, I've got to do this before I leave. So I think that pondering our own death seriously can function the same way as this traditional belief in the setting coming, which in other ways puzzles me. But I want to end with this. I want to end with this, which is maybe the biggest challenge for me, because I actually have gotten into the habit of imagining my deathbed almost daily and going and looking at my life from that point of view and thinking what I should do. I think that this whole series has been about the future, right? But it's also important not to focus solely on the future. And so I'd like to end this series by reading you some paragraphs from a book I ran across a number of years ago. This book was written in 1963. And I'm going to read these paragraphs in order to get to the final paragraph. It's called Through the Valley of the Kwai. And it was written by a POW in Thailand who had been there in the Second World War. The day's work had ended, the tools were being counted. When the party was about to be dismissed, the guard declared that a shovel was missing. He insisted someone had stolen it to sell it to the Thais. He strode up and down in front of the men, ranting and denouncing them for their wickedness, their stupidity, and most unforgivable of all, their ingratitude to the emperor. Screaming in broken English, he demanded that the guilty one step forward to take his punishment. No one moved. The guard's rage reached new heights of violence. All die, he shrieked. At that moment, a Scotsman from Argyll stepped forward, stood stiffly to attention, and said calmly, I did it. The guard unleashed all his whipped up hatred. He kicked the hapless prisoner and beat him with his fists. Still, the Argyle stood rigidly at attention. The blood was streaming down his face, but he made no sound. His silence goaded the guard to an excess of rage. He seized his rifle by the barrel and lifted it high over his head. With a final howl, he brought the butt down on the skull of the Argyle, who sank limply to the ground and did not move. Although it was perfectly evident that he was dead, the guard continued to beat him and stopped only when exhausted. The men of the work detail picked up their comrade's body, shouldered their tools, and marched back to camp. When the tools were counted again at the guardhouse, no shovel was missing. As this story was retold, remarkably enough, admiration for the Argyle transcended hatred for our captors. News of similar conduct began to reach our ears from other camps. One incident concerned an Aussie private who had been caught outside the fence while trying to obtain medicine from the Thais for his sick friends. He was summarily tried and sentenced to death. On the morning set for his execution, he marched cheerfully between his guards to the parade ground. The Japanese were out in full force to observe the scene. The Aussie was permitted to have his commanding officer and a chaplain in attendance as witnesses. The party came to a halt. The CO and the chaplain were waved to one side. The Aussie was left standing alone. Calmly, he surveyed his executioners. Then he drew a small copy of the New Testament from a pocket of his ragged shorts. He read a passage unhurriedly to himself. His lips moved, but no sound came from them. What that passage was, no one will ever know. Death was still with us, no doubt about that, but we were being slowly freed from its destructive grip. We were seeing for ourselves a sharp contrast between the forces that made for life and those that made for death. Selfishness, hatred, jealousy, and greed were all anti-life. Love, self-sacrifice, mercy, and creative faith, on the other hand, were the essence of life, turning mere existence into living in its truest sense. These were the gifts of God to us. We began to notice these forces at work around us. I was hobbling back to my shed, to my shack, after a rather late discussion session. Passing one of the huts, I stopped. I thought I heard the sound of men singing. They were singing Jerusalem the Golden. Someone was beating time on a piece of tin with a stick. The words of the grand old hymn seemed symbolic to me as I listened. Maybe Jerusalem, the kingdom of God, is here after all, with Melchizedek blessed. Maybe man shall not live by bread alone or vice alone, as we were literally doing. Maybe there is milk and honey of the spirit that puts hope into people's eyes in a song on their lips. Okay, that's the end of that long quotation. My view is that we are, in effect, all POWs from time to time. Sometimes everything has gone wrong or everything is horrific. Sometimes everything is a nightmare and we are in it. And sometimes that's all there is. It's just a nightmare. But sometimes also, some of us seemingly find ourselves able to glimpse the kingdom of God in the midst of our nightmare. The end. I'm done with this.
Wow.
I will be happy if there are any questions to attempt to answer.
Thank you, Dale. We have a few minutes before we begin. Bob and Frank.
Thank you for your presentation. I was curious, looking at your the Pew Research Center's data on the back, and it struck to, I was struck to find that historically Black and Black communities high percentages compared to other demographics. And I was wondering if you could speak to that in terms of your hypothesis of why you think that may be.
Well, so there are social psychologists who study something called millennialism. And I guess the easiest way to say this is people who are hoping for the world to change radically. And it's obvious that some groups have a larger number of people who hope for that than other groups. So that's part of that. But something that does come to mind, and I don't know how to draw the historical lines here, but there was a huge hope for the second coming of Jesus in the 1860s among African-American slaves, a huge, huge hope. And you can see it in a lot of the old so-called Negro spirituals, right? And I read on this, and apparently, when Jesus didn't come, even though, you know, the North won the Civil War and so on, African Americans fell into three groups, and I don't know the details of this, but there were people who simply said Jesus didn't come, so we're giving up that religion. And then there were those who said, guys, our focus on the future didn't work, let's just focus on the present. How do we find God in the present? And so there are African American groups that begin to marginalize the second coming stuff. But then there are other groups who just continue on, and they continue to focus on the second coming and have that hope. Now, I don't know. So that stuff I read about the 1860s and 70s, I don't know how that feeds into what happens in the 20th century, right, or later on. But I do know that there was, at least going back to the 1860s, a huge number of enslaved persons who were the only way out of this is not Abraham Lincoln. It's Jesus going to come and fix it. And it didn't happen the way that they envisaged that. Yeah, I forgot to talk about that chart. It's probably on the last page there. It's a really interesting chart, isn't it? And it's almost, look, almost half of Christian adults in this country think that we are living in the end times. That's a really astounding statistic, isn't it? It's really astounding. You wonder how it affects the way people think about things. Yes.
So you mentioned that you don't encourage your students to read, or yet so many Americans believe this stuff.
Yeah.
Don't, as pastors coming out of seminary, shouldn't we know what we're dealing with?
Yes, you're right. And so I guess I should qualify what I said. Yes, I do want them to know about this literature. I do want them to know where it comes from. I do want them to know that even if they don't buy into it, it's really important. So I know that in tons of churches, even though the pastor may never breathe a word of this sort of thing, there are people in the pews who are reading the books and watching the films and are thinking, yeah, this is what we all think about this. So yeah, what I meant, I suppose, is I don't encourage them to read this literature expecting to find the truth, okay? I expect them to find, well, I was going to say art, but it's not even art. I probably tried to read the First Left Behind book, and I just couldn't do it because it was so poorly written. This one wasn't a good novel.
My question is, I guess I kind of believe that God has already come. And you know, our challenge is to kind of use our spiritual senses to see God in the midst of both good and evil, and to know that God will never leave us in any circumstance. And I just wonder what you think about that.
Well, I agree wholeheartedly, except there's the existential question. So the passage that I read at the end bothers me because there have been times when I have been in horrible situations, in my own nightmares, and I had trouble finding God in those times. They were just so horrible that God seemed to be absent, or at least I didn't know how. And I don't know if that's just being human or that's my fault, but I do know that there are stories like this, and I have friends who tell me stories like this, of being in what I would consider hell and wondering how I could get through this and how I could think of God as loving me in the midst of that. And they say, no, I was there and I could do that. I'm just not sure I'm very good at that, right? just to be candid, not to pretend. There was a point in my life when I was genuinely flat broke. I had no money and I was desperate. And I remember walking out of church on Good Friday. I didn't care. I just wanted to have enough money to put food on the table. And the religious service didn't work for me, right? Now, I don't admire that person who walked out, but I have to be honest and say, that's what happened. Right? I was so miserable, I just left.
Okay, well, it's 20 after, and we usually have the worship service, so we will all be worshiping together and finding the presence of God. I want to say thank you for Dale's time with us over the past 5 weeks and for all the work that has gone into his presentations today, or these weeks. So thank you for being here. God bless, and we'll see you in worship.
More to say there.
Yeah. I thought I